Welcome to Agile Roots 2010, sponsored by Version 1, Rally Software, Vireo, Amirsys, Agile Alliance, and X-Mission Internet. Toxic Code, Technical Debt Analytics, by Israel Gatt and John Heintz. In terms of looking at your debt
versus yield cost versus the value of that logic. For example, if you go back to the third statement here, the one about toxic assets in the financial context, the characterization of a toxic asset is an asset where the loan is equivalent to the value. So nothing is left in it when you take a loan which is 100% of the value of the asset. The same thing happens to us, and again, more frequently than you might realize, in terms of code. We expect the code to generate $10 million or $15 million or $20 million in revenues. However, the situation might be that the code will only generate $5 million in revenues. So all of a sudden, we have a code or a code base where our technical debt on it exceeds the amount of money that we can expect to get in the market. And this is what we call toxic code. Namely, I reach a point in which I put so much technical debt on my code that the revenue stream in the future will not compensate for it. And you of course have to ask yourself the question, is it worth fixing it in the first place, even though I will never get taxed it? So the relationship of time to money at the conceptual level is this thing that there is a certain amount of time that I need to pay back, and there is a dollar amount that goes with it. Specifically, when you look at the code at a certain point in time, the way you go about calculating it is as follows. You start with code analysis, and the code analysis these days can give you all of the quality deficits that you have in your code. Against each one of the quality deficits, you take some industry norms as to how long it would take to fix the deficit. For example, it might take on the average 15 minutes of time to fix missing braces in a Java if statement. You sum up all the times, 20 minutes here, 1 hour there, 3 hours on another deficit, etc., and you get a grand total for the amount of time that you need to pay back. And then you use your cost data to monetize it. So, for example, if we run code analysis and find that the grand total of all the quality deficits is the equivalent of 1 year, then the technical debt in terms of money is something like $150,000 or $200,000 or the like. So what we have here is convergence between two areas of quite different disciplines. On the one hand, we have the financial discipline, and on the technical side, we have the code analysis techniques and metrics, which enables us to get the two things together. Now, how does our technical debt get generated? And it gets generated in an explicit form as part of resource allocation. We are going to allocate so much money for doing new features. We are going to allocate so much money for cost cutting, so much money for tactical sales opportunities, etc. And we allocate no money or very little money to the business of pushing back on the technical debts and reducing it on an ongoing basis. So the explicit flow is basically some resource allocation that we as managers or our managers take in terms of where would the money available to our R&D go. Now, the quote that you see on the board, on the projector there, is from one of my clients, and this was from the CTO there, when I really asked him how the situation became so bad in terms of the quality of the code. The answer that I got was basically a resource allocation decision. Namely, they put all their effort into testing functionality, assuming that this would be good enough, that they would be able to get into the other deficits to it, and completely neglected anything related to unit testing in this process. So a skew in the allocation of your resources, even if you're doing testing, can create a situation that the technical debt owes you. There are two other forms which I would say are like the nature of things. One is, I have the best intention as a programmer to come back to my code after I shift it and really do the refactoring, etc. But what happens is the pressure on me to put out this function, to put out that feature, is so relentless that I never manage to find a week of time to go back to my code and fix it. Even so, obviously, 1 year down the road, my memories of what I need to fix are much poorer than my memories right now. So what happens? While the obvious economical benefit is to go and fix the code as soon as you can find the time, the ongoing pressures oftentimes stand in the way and... The ongoing economical pressures to put the function feature out. Can you hear me? Put the function and features out in the market, create a situation where I'm unable to complete. I can find half an hour here and 2 hours there, but I cannot generate 1 week worth of effort to go back and fix the code. The other thing that happens, and it's a phenomenon that perhaps we don't pay enough attention to, is that software decays. Software, like any compound object in nature, decays over time, and while you don't really see literal rust on top of software, the fact of the matter, the structure of the software decays over time because you do this fix and you do that fix, and the original logic and structure are deteriorating as function of time. Now, this has an effect which becomes worse and worse over time. What you see here is a slide from Jim Highsmith, which on one axis shows cost of change in software system, and on the other hand, shows on the other dimensions, shows the time since a product was released. Now, the lower curve here, the optimal cost of change, is for a team who, on an ongoing basis, pushes back on the technical debt, let's say, spends 20-25% of their time on refactoring yet again. However, teams that neglect pushing back on technical debt happen to find themselves on the actual cost of change curve, which is a high rising exponent. And what happens if you are not good at pushing hard back on it at earlier stages, when you find yourself at this point in time on the right hand side, a few things are very painful. A, your ability to respond to your customers goes down the drain because the code is decaying to that extent now that whenever I do a fix, I interject 0.3 new bugs, or 0.5 new bugs, etc. So the work of fixing the software creates its own problems. Second, you don't really have an option once you are on the right-hand side of the slide. If you leave things as is, then they just continue to deteriorate and become worse because the exponent continues to grow. If you say something like, oh, I'm sick and tired of this code and of this team, I want to acquire a new company with beautiful software and run for me with it from now on, the fact of the matter is that even under the very best of circumstances, for a couple of years, you will have two code bases. And you will have all the problems of migration from the previous code base to the new one on your hands. So this is not as attractive, even so it may look shiny. Not as attractive as it may sound. And last but not least, when you are here, you can say, okay, I get it. I should have pushed back on the technical debt all along, and I will do it now. What happens, however, is that now you are telling as a mountain of technical debt. And there is a huge difference between being able to cushion it on an ongoing basis versus needing to take the whole mountain under various economic and business pressures. As a matter of fact, the situation is so bad that for lagging projects, and lagging you can think, roughly speaking, about projects who do not push out the technical debt, they lose their value within 3 to 5 years. Now, think about products in your company or in your company's portfolio. I am sure that everyone here has a whole bunch of products that are older than 3 years, 5 years, or the like. So what happens is, by not pushing back on the technical debt, you are creating toxic assets, assets whose value is already zero because of the technical debt. And furthermore, assets are toxic because other components in your software portfolio depend on those, and those are very, very useful. So the phenomenon is a very, very painful phenomenon, and as John and myself would exemplify, more prevalent than perhaps you want to realize. But before we get into that, the natural question to ask is, okay, how do we go about measuring technical debt? Namely, at this point in time, we go back to our offices. How do we know what is the amount of technical debt? And for that, I will hand it over to the capable hands of John.
The slides are fine.
Metaphor. I suffer from arthritis, and from blindness. Kyoto and he takes a look at it. Sometimes the news is not too good and I have my pain, etc. There is no reason to shoot the doctor because he or she is interpreting the x-rays. And there is no reason to shoot myself because arthritis is somewhere in the genes. And, you know, being tough on my own genes is not the best strategy. So my overall philosophy about measuring the technical depth, that it's of the same nature. And this is a phenomenon that you need to monitor and to respond to, and if possible, prevent. But this is not something over which you get mad at the team or you get mad at yourself. And getting mad at the code usually is not an effective strategy either.
So, some of the other characteristics that are shown on this, there is a percentage up there, the 19.5%. That is a ratio of debt in this project. All things that could have gone wrong represents 100%, and that 19% represents how many things, code violations, undocumented public APIs, non-covered code, failing unit tests, that represents how many things did actually happen that raised a red flag in terms of the tool. Other details about the code base, 350 classes, 25,000 plus lines of code, and so on. A few more details. This is some of the more static analysis that this tool shows. This is the rules compliance, 74.6% rules compliance. These are rules defined in terms of groups of coding rules, efficiency, maintainability, durability, and so on and so on. I'm not going to go through all the details, especially given our time. We can see that this project has zero blocking rule violations. It does have a set of critical violations, 34 of them. But both of those are fairly low numbers for top-level, high-end rule violations for a project. This is all part of the dashboard of the system. Now, given that we've just looked at where are we today with this code base, something else we can do is we can look at where we come from and what has happened in the past, and how are we trending. And one of the things, this is a timeline that I put together by instrumenting about the last year's worth of public releases, top-end releases for Cassandra, from 0.2 to 3, 4, 5, 5.1, and so on, up to the latest 0.6.2. We can see I put three different things on here: code coverage, complexity per class, and technical debt. The code coverage has been rising from zero upwards. The complexity per class and technical debt, they dropped off considerably, where the technical debt bottomed out at the 0.4 release. What date is that? 9/1/09. That release measures as having the lowest technical debt. And that technical debt has trended upward since then. And something that Israel is going to talk about in the next section is the governance and risk management associated with knowing these types of things. And that's something that we'll get to next. Here, though, it's just to demonstrate that you can do this instrumentation over time. And I did it by getting a version control repository and instrumenting these versions. Given that we know these things and we have these x-rays, what are we going to do about it and focus on for the next work that we look at? This is two things from the dashboard, the component model and a heat map of the system. On the right hand side, the diagram is a heat map. This heat map is a ratio of lines of code to technical debt ratio. So the bigger the block, the more lines of code. And the colors, let me see, actually, yeah, that sickly green-yellow color represents higher technical debt. A nice vivid green would be lower technical debt. I've actually left the hover over on one of these components to show it. The Apache Cassandra Avro is a remote communication protocol. This one package of Java code, this component, has a 29.2% technical debt ratio. And we can see also that shows up in the component model, in this case, sorted by complexity, as the highest complexity component in the Cassandra system. And that complexity and also its unit test coverage both gave it the highest ratio of technical debt, or one of the highest ratios. So we can see that this heat map, this component list, give us a place to focus on. It gives us some insights into where we ought to look. And it's not a sure thing that that's the right place for us to focus on next to the project, but this provides potential data that we can use to help make those decisions. And with that, just a quick note, tomorrow at lunch we'll be demonstrating that tool, and with that, I'll hand this all back to Israel.
Thank you, John. I would just mention that we put some data sheets out on the tables, so you are welcome to it. They give some extra details that we don't have the time to address in the presentation. The perhaps most important thing about technical debt is the ability to use it for governments, and I would actually use the word enlightened governments. Namely, we are not really talking here about command and control. We are really talking here about the government, which is responsive to indicators which are in the code. And the thinking about it is as follows. What you see on the left-hand side is a traditional iron triangle with cost, scope, and schedule as the three parameters that we focus on. And this suffers from two major defects, at least in my humble opinion. Very difficult to put focus on value, and very difficult to put focus on quality. What you see on the right-hand side is a triangle that clamps all the three from the previous one, namely schedule, scope, and cost, into the category of constraints on the right-hand side of the triangle. Here's the value at the top of the triangle and quality at the bottom of the triangle. And the premise is that one can very, very effectively run with his or her software project by way of focusing on just those three. And the way that this is done is as follows. If you take a look at the right-hand side there, cost is obviously done in dollars, or number of days that people spend, and you convert it into dollars. So this traditionally is done through dollars. Value, in this example, is expressed through the net present value of the revenue streams that you expect to get out of the product. And this data is usually readily available from the business case. Quality, or lack of, we express through the technical debt that we have spoken about so far. So, for example, you may have a project where you expect a value of $100 million, you invested in it $10 million, and your current technical debt in it is $5 million. And the great power of those three simple in unison is that you can compare one with another. You can have many other frameworks, let's say, for value, and they are all valuable. However, when you use those three, you can make direct comparisons, and you can actually open up the dialogue for non-technical people to be part of the game together with technical people. And let me show a few examples. The first example here is a hypothetical dialogue, and I don't even think that we need to know who was the product owner, who was the boss of the product owner, and who was the project lead, or the Scrum Master, etc. But what you basically see in the pie chart is the distribution of the technical debt at a certain point in time. And obviously, in this example, the lack of unit test is the number one deficit, at least in terms of size. Now, out of the dialogue here, they reach a conclusion that they will bring up test coverage to 70% of the current deficit, and they will then ship and do the rest of it afterwards. Now, you may or may not agree with this strategy. You may say, oh, we should start with duplication, and I don't have any problems with that. But what I'm trying to get across here is, here you have a simple way by which your business people and your very, very technical people can understand the magnitude and the nature of the problem and what to do about it. Because if you are going to go to your CFO and say, well, you know, it's lack of cohesion among methods, probably you will not get too much of a dialogue out of this kind of statement. While here, even in the details around complexity, for example, are not really known to the person with whom you speak, he or she or that would understand that $500,000 in complexity, or whatever the figure is something to pay attention to. So A, you are able to enrich and to open up the dialogue to other constituencies. B, you have a wonderful opportunity to work on technical debt one bit at a time, instead of at the end, when you need to stare at a mountain. And here is a story. What you see in the picture, in the chart here, is a process control view of the scrum process. You have the inputs or the requirements on the left-hand side. You have the output on the right-hand side in the form of the code data. And you have the control unit in terms of the scrum meeting at 8:15 in the morning or the night. Now, what happens, you can tie the technical debt criteria into the build. And just like you fail the build when it does not compile, you fail a build when it fails to satisfy some technical debt criteria. So for example, one of my clients, whenever the technical debt goes higher from the previous reading to the next reading, they stop the line and everyone goes to work on it. And the philosophy around it is that when things are fresh on our minds, when we can really see that this was a result of checking in this piece or that piece, etc., the amount of effort that is necessary to eliminate or to reduce the technical debt is much smaller than the amount of effort we need to put in 3 months or 6 months or 9 months down the road. And you can play with all kinds of parameters of technical debt as part of the build process. And actually, if you are continuously integrating in a very aggressive manner, you can expect that you will have build fails a few times a day. And you drive the process much more now by the build fails rather than by the scrum process itself. So, once you instrument your code, you can do the technical debt readings as part of your build process. Once you do it as part of your build process, you can easily use it as a criterion to decide the build pass, the build fail, etc., and addressing one build at a time. Now, this could be this, I don't want to call it mechanistics, but this way of addressing technical debt, namely whenever it goes higher, I stop the line, maybe too much of a good thing. For example, if my technical debt is $1 million and the new reading is $1,000,001, does it really make enough of a difference to stop the line? The beauty of it is that you can take statistical process control methods and apply them to the technical debt readings. And what you see here is what the statisticians call control chart. Namely, you have the mean of the readings in the middle. You have graph one line, two standard deviations above it, and you have another line, three standard deviations above it. And you establish your economic policy in accord with those readings. For example, the economic policy could be that if the technical debt is higher than two standard deviations, then you stop the line and go to work. So you have the flexibility not just to take $1 million and one is bigger than $1 million and the floor will stop. You have the flexibility to play with standard deviations in accord with the quality of the process that you have at any point in time. And people have actually experimented with various additional rules that I don't have the time to get into. But for example, if you have 5 or 7 consecutive readings which are between one standard deviation and two standard deviations, this could be a reason to stop the line and start working on the technical debt. So you don't need to do it mechanistically, you can do it under statistical process control based on the readings of the technical data. Now, John was kind enough to mention the business of the risk because, you know, the annals of software projects are filled with spectacular failure of so many projects. And I would contend that the major reason for that is simply that there was no way to understand the risk at the right point in time. And you know, at the point in time that people stare at the catastrophe, they prefer to continue with the catastrophe, probably. Technical debt is actually a wonderful way to tell you about your risks. For example, if you have 1 million lines of code and you've got a technical debt of $1 million, then your debt density is $1 per line of code. Maybe this is not great, but you can certainly live with it. On the other hand, if you have $10 million in debt on 1 million lines of code, the debt density is $10 per line of code. And this might make you think a little bit about what is really happening here. Because for various environments, the amount of technical debt is higher than the cost that you would accrue in producing this code. And this is equivalent to, instead of building equity, taking more and more debt. So you can look at technical debt with respect to cost or respect to line of code as indicative of the risk that you are facing. Furthermore, technical debt has a wonderful predictive capability, which is demonstrated in the upper chart here. What you see here is a study of 12 Java projects where one axis was the prominence of a file to be error-prone and the other axis was a complexity per file. And what you see is that when it reaches 74, complexity of 74, you are pretty much guaranteed to have an error-prone class on your hand. On the other hand, if it reaches the level of 38, I believe it's there, then your probability is only 0.5. Now, this has tremendous economic value because, you know, usually error-prone models follow a 550 kind of a rule, namely 5% of the models create 50% of the bugs in the field. Now, when you have this kind of correlation metric in the phase of development, you don't need to wait till you get the bug reports from the field and then start fixing. You can be preventive and start working on the error-prone classes when they are still in the bug. So it's not only a good risk measure at any point in time, it's a risk measure with a productive ability. One last example, and I will just touch on it very, very quickly because it's similar to the heat maps that John has already spoken about. What you see here is a heat map for a bunch of modules. And size represents complexity, and color represents quality of coding. So for example, P2 here is more complex than P5 because it's bigger in size than P5. However, the quality of the coding on P5 is quite crappy, while P2 has a much better quality of coding. So you would probably go to P5 in this characteristic instead of going after P2, or maybe you would go after P1. So you have a roadmap, if you please, as to what you need to do in terms of selectively addressing your technical debt instead of looking at unbelievable amount and saying, oh my gosh, what am I going to do about it? And this brings us to what I consider in some ways the most interesting property of technical debt, which is it's rooted in Agile philosophy and principles, but it applies to any project whatsoever. So, if you are in continuous integration and Agile and all the rest of the good stuff, and you are building 12 times a day, it probably applies to you. However, if you are doing an on-demand waterfall or any other method in your environment, the fact of the matter is you continue to do precisely the same thing, because cost, value, and technical debt have got nothing whatsoever to do with the software method underneath. And you can go into your waterfall code at any point in time that you desire and run the technical debt on it. So if you take a look at the project here, the project shows three parameters: the cost, the technical debt, and the net present value. At the start of the project, we have a certain net present value from the business case.
Okay, we're still.
We start working on the project and we accrue cost in a linear manner. Another week passed, another week passed, etc. At time T1, we take a measure and we find that actually we accrue a lot of technical debt. At this point in time, two things happen. A, you probably need to adjust your net present value because you are likely to be late or with less features, and certainly your risk is higher. So net present value has a singular point here going down. The other thing that you do, you probably store new function features, and as long as you are within the zone Z1, you are focusing on reducing the technical debt. At a certain point in time, T2, which is the intersection of the cost line with the technical debt line, the two intersect each other. And while at this point in time, not all everything is well, you are in a much better shape than you were in point T1. And you can expect certain velocity to be picked up due to the fact that the technical debt is lower. This is represented here by stopping to decrease the net present value. And you know that you still have work to do, but you are saying worst is behind us. Now, what is happening at time T3 when the technical debt is pushed down to a more acceptable level is that actually your velocity picks up, possibly in a very significant manner. And if you really push the technical debt down really well, you could expect your net present value to be ultimately higher than that that you originally thought about, because your velocity is probably better than the velocity that was stipulated in the original business case. So this is one way in which various projects evolve. There are many, many other patterns. But in terms of being able to govern the software process, you don't need Agile, you don't need continuous integration with any software method that you might be working. This will do the job. So, what are the takeaways from this discussion? We as evangelists oftentimes have allergic reaction to the word governance. And what I want to hopefully convince you that we are talking about enlightened governance here. Maybe we are talking about me as a developer or tester or a person who writes documentation, getting data about what I do well, what I don't do well, and it can be specifically granular for me to go to the individual line of code and say, oh my gosh, I messed up here and I need to fix it. So we are talking about enlightened governance, or if I may use a word following Sanjeev, Augustine from the previous presentation, intrinsic governance. It's not arbitrary, it's what the code tells us about its quality. So it's not an ugly word, it's not a command and control word, it's about enlightened way to steal the code. Second, as I mentioned, it's rooted in Agile philosophy and principles, but it's applicable to any software method. So your environment may include any number of software methods. You are able to do apple-to-apple oranges by way of technical debt across your work portfolio. So even if you are planning ultimately to be 100% Agile, and you are in an interim period in which you are working towards it, or whether you plan just 50% Agile and the rest other kind of methods, you have a way to look at your overall software project portfolio in a quantitative manner, in a meaningful manner across the board. And last but not least, the business of the toxic code. If you look that the visibility transparency was not there. And we all find it in a very hard way in September, I think, or something like that. I am becoming, unfortunately, more and more convinced that the situation within the software industry, particularly with respect to legacy code, is not any better. And if there is a ton of code that I run into, and I think you might be running into, which in the lexicon that you defined here, I would define as toxic code. And what I'm very, very worried about is that people let it rest there instead of trying to share light on it and start taking steps to reduce it before we have a single crisis in the software industry. I'm sorry to have run my time a little bit, and thank you very much. If there are any questions, I see people come.